that clear atmosphere could even distinguish the bent form of our friend, the old abbot, Kuen, leaning against it until we were quite lost to sight. All the monks had wept when we parted from them, and Kuen even more bitterly than the rest, for he had learned to love us. "I am grieved," he said, "much grieved, which indeed I should not be, for such emotion partakes of sin. Yet I find comfort, for I know well that although I must soon leave this present life, yet we shall meet again in many future incarnations, and after you have put away these follies, together tread the path to perfect peace. Now take with you my blessings and my prayers and be gone, forgetting not that should you live to return," and he shook his head doubtfully, "here you will be ever welcome." So we embraced him and went sorrowfully. It will be remembered that when the mysterious light fell upon us at the peak, I had my compass with me, and was able roughly to take its bearings. For lack of any better guide, we now followed these bearings, traveling almost due northeast, for in that direction had shone the fire. All day, in the most beautiful weather, we marched across the flower-strewn desert, seeing nothing except bunches of game and one or two herds of wild asses which had come down from the mountains to feed upon the new grass. As evening approached, we shot an antelope and made our camp, for we had brought the yak and the tent with us, among some tamarisk scrub, of which the dry stems furnished us with fuel. Nor did we lack for water, since by scraping in the sand, soaked with melted snow, we found plenty of fair quality. So that night we supped in luxury upon tea and antelope meat, which indeed we were glad to have, as it spared our little store of dried provisions. The next morning we ascertained our position as well as we could, and estimated that we had crossed about a quarter of the desert, a guess
ready to row
very accurate, for on the evening of the fourth day of our journey we reached the bottom slopes of the opposing mountains without having experienced either accident or fatigue. As Leo said, things were going like clockwork, but I reminded him that a good start often meant a bad finish. And nor was I wrong, for now to begin with, the mountains proved to be exceeding high. It took us 2 days to climb the enormous slopes. Also, the heat of the sun had softened the snow, which made warmth for the fires, whilst accustomed to such conditions, its continual glitter affected our eyes. The morning of the seventh day found us in Alpha 8 to 5. Seemed the only possible path, and we were much cheered to discover that the end was not as far. Not that we could see any road, indeed, for everything was buried in snow, but that one lay beneath our feet, we were certain, since although we marched along the edge of precipices, our path, however steep, was always flat. Moreover, the rock upon one side of it had often been scarped by the hand of man. Of this there could be no doubt, for as the snow did not cling here, we saw the tool marks upon its bare surface. Also, we came to several places where galleries had been built out from the mountainside by means of beams let into it, as is still a common practice in Tibet. These beams, of course, had long since rotted away, leaving a gulf between us and the continuation of the path. When we met with such gaps, we were forced to go back and make a detour round or over some mountain. But although much delayed thereby, as it happened, we always managed to regain the road, not without difficulty and danger. What tried us more for here our skill and experience as mountaineers could not help us, was the cold at night, obliged as we were to camp in the severe frost at a great altitude, and to endure through the long hours of darkness, penetrating and icy winds, which soughed ceaselessly down the pass. At length, on the 10th day, we reached the end of the defile, and as night was falling, camped there in the most bitter cold. Those were miserable hours, for now we had no fuel with which to boil water, and must satisfy our thirst by eating frozen snow, while our eyes smarted so sorely that we could not sleep. And notwithstanding all our wraps and the warmth that we gathered from the yak in the little tent, the cold caused our teeth to chatter like castanets. What's up there, BWDP? How you doing? Thank you for the follow. Very kindly. And yeah, and that is not the name of the book that we're reading. Says right there. But yeah. Ooh. Feel free to throw around some book club stickers. I'm down with that. Monday through Thursday we do this. Okay. The cold caused our teeth to chatter like castanets. The dawn came, and after it, the sunrise. We crept from the tent, and leaving it standing a while, dragged our stiffened limbs 100 yards or so to a spot where the defile took a turn, in order that we might thaw in the rays of the sun, which at that hour could not reach us where we had camped. R.I.P.? Uh-oh. What's R.I.P.? They're not frozen to death yet. Leo was round at first, and I heard him utter an exclamation. In a few seconds, I reached his side, and lo, before us lay our promised land. Oh, dear, spark balance. Really? I can't seem to give these things away fast enough. I gave away like 2.5 million of them last week. And, let's see, I still got 1.8. They build up fast. I have streams running in the background while and stuff. While I'm working, I'll have a stream on in the background going on a tablet or something like that. No, you can't use them on yourself. No, they made sure of that. Yeah. Although, almost everyone has at least one little like secondary account or something like that. It's not sustainable. It's not. I don't want to go into it. It makes no sense at all the way they've done it. Okay, so they've reached the promised land. Far beneath us, 10,000 feet at least, for it must be remembered that we viewed it from the top of a mountain. It stretched away and away till its distances met the horizon. In character, it was quite flat, an alluvial plain that probably, in some primeval age, had been the bottom of one of the vast lakes, of which a number exist in Central Asia, most of them now in process of desiccation. One object only relieved this dreary flatness, a single snow-clad and gigantic mountain, of which, even at that distance, for it was very far from us, we could clearly see the outline. Indeed, we could see more, for from its rounded crest rose a great plume of smoke, showing that it was an active volcano, and on the hither lip, an enormous pillar of rock, whereof the top was formed to the shape of a loop. Yes, there it stood before us, that symbol of our vision which we had sought these many years, and at the sight of it our hearts beat fast and our breath came quickly. We noted at once that, although we had not seen it during our passage of the mountains, since the peaks ahead and the rocky sides of the defile hid it from view, so great was its height that it overtopped the tallest of them. This made it clear to us how it came to be possible that the ray of light passing through the loop could fall upon the highest snows of that towering pinnacle which we had climbed upon the further side of the desert. I haven't seen it. The great of its height. Okay, right. Also now, we were certain of the cause of that ray, for the smoke behind the loop explained this mystery. Doubtless, at times, when the volcano was awake, that smoke must be replaced by flame, emitting light of fearful intensity, and this light it was that reached us, concentrated and directed by the loop. For the rest, we thought that, about 30 miles away, we could make out a white-roofed town, set upon a mound, situated among trees upon the banks of a wide river, which flowed across the plain. Also, it was evident that this country had a large population who cultivated the soil, for by the aid of a pair of field glasses, one of our few remaining and most cherished possessions, we could see the green of springing crops pierced by irrigation canals and the lines of trees that marked the limits of the fields. Yes, there before us stretched the promised land, and there rose the mystic mount, so that all we had to do was to march down the snow slopes and enter it where we would. Thus, we thought in our folly, little guessing what lay before us, what terrors and weary suffering we must endure before we stood at length beneath the shadow of the symbol of life. Our fatigues forgotten, we returned to the tent, hastily swallowed some of our dried food, which we washed down with lumps of snow that gave us toothache and chilled us inside, but which thirst compelled us to eat, dragged the poor yak to its feet, loaded it up, and started. Where are you getting the, okay, don't know where the Ninja Turtle thing came from. Right, it's okay. Oh, and started. All this while, so great was our haste and so occupied were each of us with our own thoughts that, if my memory serve me, we scarcely interchanged a word. Down the snow slopes we marched swiftly and without hesitation, for here the road was marked for us by means of pillars of rock set opposite to one another at intervals. These pillars we observed with satisfaction, for they told us that we were still upon a highway which led to the promised land. Yet, as we could not help noting, it was one which seemed to have gone out of use, since with the exception of a few wild sheep tracks and the spoor of some deers and mountain foxes, not a single sign of beast or man could we discover. Hey, need a little shadow? Little terror? Shadow. Good. Just take a... minimize it. And simply red. That sticker's a work in progress. I want to change that up a lot. It's not exactly what I was after. We can do that at when we finish up here, but be about 20 minutes or so, 25 maybe, something like that. Where are we at? No! Shadowtronics is
Yeah. It's very true, but I do. And lots of it. Mountains of it. Mountains of it. Shenandoah. I think I mentioned yesterday. I think it was only yesterday. You threw 10 beans into the pot there like that. But yeah. The message is still not... really weird. I don't know why the message is not... Because it didn't show up in any of the other things. I think it's something with Streamlabs. It's going to have to be something with Streamlabs. Because it didn't come through on... it didn't come through on Streamlabs notifications. It didn't come through on the email that accompanies it. And it didn't come through to where the message would be in the actual PayPal transaction. So I think it has to be something up with Streamlabs itself. Yeah, I'm gonna throw that straight into the light kitty, which is coming together very nicely. Actually, I'm gonna be throwing some stuff in my little cart tomorrow. See how that works out. That's okay. It's okay, Shadowtronics. Streamlabs is not working properly. It's beyond our control. I like that one. Hail, King Carrington. May he reign forever in the realm of... Oops, I dig it. Thanks, man. Little Terra's body is sleepy, but your mind is not. If your body's telling you you need some Z's, you might want to listen to your body, man. Might want to listen to that. Alright. Thank you again, Shadow. Thank you again. I'm almost in a position to go get that I didn't get this weekend. You lost some blood. Well, you should definitely think about getting some Z's then. Alright. Or perhaps the, yet as we could not help noting, it was one which seemed to have gone out of use, with the exception of a few wild sheep tracks. This is the track that they're following. Oh, you're getting a green screen? Nice. Not a single sign of beast or man could we discover. This, however, was to be explained, we reflected, by the fact that doubtless the road was only used in the summer season. Or perhaps the inhabitants of the country were now stay-at-home people who never traveled it at all. Those slopes were longer than we thought. Indeed, when darkness closed in, we had not reached the foot of them. So we were obliged to spend another night in the snow, pitching our tent in the shelter of an overhanging rock. As we had descended many thousand feet, the temperature proved, fortunately, a little milder. Indeed, I do not think that there were more than 18 or 20 degrees of frost that night. Also, here and there, the heat of the sun had melted the snow in secluded places, so that we were able to find water to drink, while the yak could fill its poor old stomach with dead-looking mountain mosses, which it seemed to think better than nothing. Again, the still dawn came, throwing its red garment over the lonesome, endless mountains, and we dragged ourselves to our numbered feet, ate some of our remaining food, and started onwards. Now we could see no longer the country beneath, for it and even the towering volcano were hidden from us by an intervening ridge that seemed to be pierced by a single narrow gully towards which we headed. Indeed, as the pillars showed us, thither ran the buried road. By midday, it appeared quite close to us, and we tramped on in feverish haste. As it chanced, however, there was no need to hurry, for an hour later, we learned the truth. The between us and the mouth of the gully rose, or rather sank, a sheer precipice that was apparently 300 or 400 feet in depth, and at its foot we could hear the sound of water. Right to the edge of this precipice ran the path, for one of the stone pillars stood upon its extreme brink. And yet, how could a road descend such a place as that? We stared aghast. Then a possible solution occurred to us. Don't you see, said Leo with a hollow laugh, the gulf has opened since this track was used. Volcanic action, probably. Perhaps, or perhaps there was a wooden bridge or stairway which has rotted. It doesn't matter, we must find another path, that's all. I answered as cheerfully as I could. Yes, and soon, he said, if we do not wish to stop here forever. So we turned to the right and marched along the edge of the precipice till, a mile or so away, we came to a small glacier, of which the surface was sprinkled with large stones frozen into its substance. This glacier hung down the face of the cliff like a petrified waterfall. Whether or no it reached the foot, we could not discover. At any rate, to think of attempting its descent seemed out of the question. From this point onwards, we could see that the precipice increased in depth, and far as the eye could reach, it was absolutely sheer. So we went back again and searched to the left of our road. Here the mountains receded so that above us rose a mighty, dazzling slope of snow, and below us lay that same pitiless, unclimbable gulf. As the light began to fade, we perceived, half a mile or more in front, a bare-topped hillock of rock, which stood on the verge of the precipice, and hurried to it, thinking that from its crest we might be able to discover a way of descent. When at last we had struggled to the top, it was about 100 feet high. What we did discover was that here also, as beyond the glacier, the gulf was infinitely deeper than at that spot where the road ended, so deep indeed that we could not see its bottom, although from it came the sound of roaring water. Moreover, it was quite half a mile in width. Whilst we stared round us, the sinking sun vanished behind a mountain, and the sky, being heavy, the light went out like that of a candle. Now the ascent of this hillock had proved so steep, especially at one place, where we were obliged to climb a sort of rock ladder, that we scarcely cared to attempt to struggle down it again in that gloom. Therefore, remembering that there was little to choose between the top of this knoll and the snow plain at the foot, in the matter of temperature or other conveniences, and being quite exhausted, we determined to spend the night upon it, thereby, as we were to learn, saving our lives. Unloading the yak, we pitched our tent under the lee of the topmost knob of rock and ate a couple of handfuls of dried fish and corn. This was the last of the food that we had brought with us from the Lamazuri, and we reflected with dismay that unless we could shoot something, our commissariat was now represented by the carcass of our old friend, the yak. Lady Death. Then we wrapped ourselves up in our thick rugs and fur garments and forgot our miseries in sleep. It cannot have been long before midnight when we were awakened by a sudden and terrific sound like the boom of a great cannon, followed by thousands of other sounds, which might be compared to the fusillade of musketry. Great heavens! What is that? I said. We crawled from the tent, but as yet could see nothing, whilst the yak began to low in a terrified manner. But if we could not see, we could hear and feel. The booming and cracking had ceased and was followed by a soft grinding noise, the most sickening sound, I think, to which I ever listened. This was accompanied by a strange, steady, unnatural wind, which seemed to press upon us as water presses. Then the dawn broke, and we saw. The mountainside was moving down upon us in a vast avalanche of snow. Oh, what a sight was that! On from the crest of the precipitous slopes above, 2 miles and more away, it came, a living thing, rolling, sliding, gliding, piling itself in long, leaping waves, furrowing itself into cavernous valleys like a tempest-driven sea, whilst above its surface hung a powdery cloud of frozen spray. As we watched, clinging to each other, terrified, the first of these waves struck our head, causing the mighty mass of solid rock to quiver like a yacht beneath the impact of an ocean wave, or an aspen in a sudden rush of wind. It struck and slowly separated, then with a majestic motion flowed over the edge of the precipice on either side and fell with a thudding sound into the unmeasured depths beneath. And this was but a little thing, a mere bird, for after it, with a slow serpentine movement, all the body of the avalanche. It hurled itself against our wing, yes, to within 50 feet of the head of it, till we thought that even that rooted rock must be torn from its foundations and hurled like a pebble to the deepest beneath. And the turmoil of it all, the screaming of the blast caused by the compression of the air, the dull, continuous thudding of the fall of millions of tons of snow as they rushed through space and ended their journey in the Gulf. Nor was this the worst of it, for as the deep snows above thinned, great boulders that had been buried beneath them, perhaps for centuries, were loosened from their resting places and began to thunder down the hill. At first they moved slowly, whirling up the hard snow as the prow of the ship rose foam. Then gathering, it sprang. The leaps, such as those of shells, ricocheted upon water, till in the end, sinking and hurtling, many of them rushed past and even over us to vanish by the wind. Some indeed struck our little mountain with the force of shock, fired from the great guns of the ship, and shattered them. Or if they fell upon its side, tore away tons of rock, and passed with them into the planet, like a meteor surrounded by its satellites. Indeed, no bombardment devised and directed by man could have been half so terrible. Or had there been anything to destroy, half so destructive. The scene was appalling. Alright, see you when you get back. Oh, you're back. The scene was appalling. It was unchained and resistless might. The scene was appalling, and its unchained and resistless might. There in the lap of the quiet mountains, looked down upon by the dead, peaceful, tender sky, the powers hidden in the breast of nature were suddenly set free, and companioned by whirlwinds and all the terrifying majesty of sound. Loosed upon the heads of us 2 human atoms. At the first rush of snow, we had left back behind our protective ship and run into the wind. Fearing lest the wind should hurl us to the abyss. Long ago, like a dead leaf in an autumn gale, and at times it seemed as if we must follow. The boulders hurtled over and past us. One of them fell full upon the little peak, shattering its crest and bursting into fragments, which fled away, each singing its own wild song. We were not touched, but when we looked behind us, it was to see the yak, which had risen in its terror, lying dead and headless. Then in our fear we lay still, waiting for the end, and wondering dimly whether we should be buried in the surging snow, or swept away with the hill, or crushed by the flying rocks, or lifted and lost in the hurricane. You go get some Z's there, little terror. It's good for you. How long did it last? we never knew. It may have been 10 minutes or 2 hours, for in such a scene, time loses its proportion. Only we became aware that the wind had fallen, while the noise of grinding snow and hurtling boulders ceased. Very cautiously, we gained our feet. In front of us was sheer mountainside. For a depth of over 2 miles, the width of about 1,000 yards, which had been covered with many feet of snow. Now bare rock. Piled up against the face of our hill, almost to its summit, lay a tongue of snow, pressed to the consistency of ice and spotted with boulders that had lodged there. The peak itself was torn and shattered, so that it revealed great gleaming surfaces and pits, which glittered mica or some other mineral. The vast gulf behind was half filled with the avalanche and its debris. But for the rest, it seemed as though nothing had happened, for the sun shone sweetly overhead, and the solemn snows reflected its rays from the sides of 100 hills. And we had endured it all, and were still alive. Yes, and unhurt. But what a position was ours. We dared not attempt to descend the mount, lest we should sink into the loose snow and be buried there. Moreover, all along the breadth of the path of the avalanche boulders, from time to time... Moreover, all along the breadth of the path of the avalanche, boulders from time to time still thundered down the rocky slope. And with them came patches of snow that had been left behind by the big slide, small in themselves, it is true, but each of them large enough to kill 100 men. It was obvious, therefore, that until these conditions changed or death released us, we must abide where we were upon the crest of the hillock. So there we sat, foodless and frightened, wondering what our old friend Kuan would say if he could see us now. By degrees, hunger mastered all our other sensations, and we began to turn longing eyes upon the headless body of the yak. "Let's skin him," said Leo. "It will be something to do, and we shall want his hide tonight." So, with affection and even reverence, we performed this office for the dead companion of our journeyings, rejoicing the while that it was not we who had brought him to his end. Indeed, long residence among peoples who believed fully that the souls of men could pass into, or were risen from, the bodies of animals, had made us a little superstitious on this matter. It would be scarcely pleasant, we reflected, in some future incarnation, find our faithful friend clad in human form, and to hear him bitterly reproach us for his murder. Being dead, however, these arguments did not apply to eating him, as we were sure he would himself acknowledge. So we cut off little bits of his flesh, and rolling them in snow till they looked as though they were nicely floured, hunger compelling us, swallowed them at a gulp. It was a disgusting meal. We felt like cannibals. But what could we do? What indeed could they do? I don't know. And there we go. And gotta do it. Oh, I'm just so tired right now. Oh, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. Then we're not gonna be able to get another chapter in there for the top of the hour. So we might have to do there. In there. Okay, so far so good though, right? I mean, it's getting right into the chase. I mean, they know exactly what they're going after this time. I think in the previous book, and they spent more than half of it, maybe even two-thirds, before they even arrived at the temple of Chi. That's right, King Carrington. That is I. All about that. All right, so what? Yeah. Anyway, so the. Good. Oh. Wow. Okay, man. I don't like it when I get the yawns like that. That's not cool. Especially when I'm streaming, I'm supposed to look like be wide awake and chipper and all. Yeah. Ooh, dance squad. Yep, we're doing more dance squad on Sunday. It's going to be pretty sweet. Pretty sweet. My mic looks a little wobbly. Yeah, it's this thing right here. Yeah, it's I have it on one of these like springy arm things. Yeah. So yeah, if you give it like a good old whack, it'll you know. What's up, Donnie Siegel? They just had a huge avalanche. Yeah. Huge avalanche. They were all camped up on top of a hill. But it's still kind of halfway down the valley. Big avalanche happened in the middle of the night, and that's what killed the yak, unfortunately. But all for the greater good. It made a tasty meal. It sounded actually pretty gross the way they were eating it. But yeah, and then they can use the skin to keep warm at night. But yeah, they barely escaped by the skin of their teeth out of that one. Huge avalanche. Those are big monsters of nature. Monsters of nature. And they can strike just like that. You might just be nipping out for like a quick shower, and then all of a sudden, boom. Avalanche. There we go. Anyway, so, that is okay. So the next chapter is too long to get done before I need to start up the next thing. So we'll continue with this on Monday. Yeah. All right. So for those who might not know, we do this Monday through Thursday. Monday through Thursday, starting at 7 p.m. Pacific. Usually about an hour and a half. Sometimes a bit longer. Do that. We do have time to sneak in a short story. We can find something. Yeah, that when the big one hits LA, that's going to be crazy. Yeah, so I'm ready for that though. Well, it's going to be absolute chaos. May as well be on again. But, let's see. Let me find a quick little short story there. Oh, and So, I was going to say, if anyone else is interested, by the way, I posted something in the public section of my Patreon page today. There, just the short little thing by Robert Frost, which is very well known. I think people take it too deep. I think that one there. It's always seemed very. Almost like whimsical to me. The road not taken. But I don't know. I mean, I've talked to people about this particular one before, and most of them are like, "Oh yeah, it's all about like regret and second guessing yourself and all this." And so I don't see it that way. So it's kind of interesting. You're hoping, but not really, that it happens during book club. I've had, there's been a few occasions where there's been earthquakes and I've been streaming. Well, actually, not only once while I've been streaming. But, I remember a couple of times playing EverQuest, back when I was playing that. There were two pretty big ones. And there's been one while I've been streaming. Like a year ago, maybe. Well, it has to be. I've only been doing this like a year and a half, around about. So I think. So it'd have to be from that time. But obviously not the big one, because if it's the big one, yeah, you're in big trouble. To talk EverQuest and see if it ever ran. Well, I mean, there's so many servers. So many servers. I was on two of them. I was on Vazil and Furionavai, which Furionavai was the role playing one. But Vazil also had like a ton of builds on it. You felt a jiggle just then? Hey, too many loot boxes, ain't there? No, the last big quake you had, yeah. You know, I remember the Northridge earthquake. That was like back in the early 90s. There, yeah, I was at the time, yeah, I was still in Los Angeles at the time. Too many loot boxes. Only ever played a demo of it. Yeah, it was an amazing game. It was a tutorial level where you couldn't do anything or even make your own character. That was, are you sure you weren't, was it a thing where you had to climb, you were a troll and you had to open a hatch and then climb down into a dungeon below? Because if it was that, that wasn't a demo. That was actually a leaked proof of concept, which somehow made it out. But yeah, I mean, there wasn't a lot to do in it. You couldn't make your own character. Yeah. Hey, Haley Dawn, how you doing? Just wrapped up a little book club there. Meow Reds! Wow, everyone put on your cat ears. Haley Dawn's coming in. Spartan Rage, Tattooed Chick, Shadowtronics. Oh, wait, no, he was here at the start. Yeah, how are you all doing tonight? Smooth Criminal, looking all chill. Got that Michael Jackson beat going down. Yeah. How are you all doing tonight? Meow, meow, meow. Meow, 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 meow. That's all I'll do from that one. And now all the pictures of the cat here is coming. That's a nice one. All right. What? Lady Death 884 loves this stream the best. Well, that's what it says on the very nice. Yeah. Spasmatic's joining in the action too. How are you doing? Spasmatic, yeah, it says Spasmatic had a long stream today. How are you all doing? And they keep going. Good gracious. Look at them go. Tons of them. All right. Well, tell you what. They've come in with a whole bunch of friends there, but I'm sure some of them don't know what we do here. So, yeah, we've just finished Book Club. We're switching over to gaming very shortly. Very shortly. It's going to be actually a dungeon crawl. Operencia, Stolen Sun. Yeah, a pretty cool dungeon crawl. But, yeah, our mainstream, Monday through Thursday, this is what we do. We read books, and this is what we've been reading right now. Aisha, The Return of She. It's like a sequel to a book that we read about 6 months ago. But it's full of supernatural events about a 2,500-year-old priestess, blessed or cursed with eternal life. I think Anne Rice borrowed quite a lot from H. Rider Haggard with these books. At least that's what I think. But yeah, set in colonial British time. Yeah, it's good stuff. All their adventures down in Africa in the first book and in Asia in this one. I'm doing well, Tattoo Chick. Yeah, well, yeah, they're all friends here a little bit. You're doing well? Very cool, very cool. Excellent. So yeah, we've just wrapped up Aisha, The Return of She. Tattoo Chick's getting ready for bed, so. Oh, nice. this is a chill place to wind a night down, that's for sure. Yeah. So, I was just going to read a short story to read before switching over to Operencia, which is going to be a pretty fun thing. So if you just give me a second there, see what we can find in our little Kindle. Little Terra's taking a little nap. Fair enough. You do that. Chris Alberti's in the house. How you doing? We've just finished, by the way, a really great science fiction book by H.G. Wells, which was The Sleeper Awakes. That was really good. Chris Alberti has been... Haley Dawn, no, she knows all the commands. Going for the good one right off the bat. There we go. I think that's at a higher... there we go. That's at a higher thing around here. Good Lord. Where are all those characters at? There they are. Ay. Alright, so, get back to this thing here. I just need to find something nice and short. Nice and short. What can we do which is nice and short? There you go. Six. Alright, so here we go. Let's just do this little short story. I need to change the title of the stream real fast. Got the original Goldilocks. On We Happy Few. Yeah, I've been meaning to try out We Happy Few. That actually looks, it looks like a very interesting game. I really like the atmosphere and the tone of it and all of that, but apparently the game was apparently not so good. Itself, the actual gameplay, but I have not tried for myself. Just changing the title here real fast. It's going to say, we've got one little short story right here, and then we're moving on to Operencia, the Stolen Sun. Why? You can change it, Spasmatic. Yeah, if you do a exclamation extension, you can change it to whatever you want. The first time someone says anything in chat, they get randomly assigned one of like 50 things, but then it remembers that person, so the next time they come back, they get it again. But yeah, you can change it any time with extension. Yeah. Exclamation extension. I'm a Pac-Man fan myself, so yeah, I'd always be down with one of those. All right, let me just check my OBS. So here we go. We got one little short story just to bring us to the top of the hour for our for book club there, and I just raised that thing too high. Okay, here we go. Let's do it. Dagon. By H.P. Lovecraft. I am writing this under an appreciable mental strain, since by tonight I shall be no more. Penniless and at the end of my supply of the drug, which alone makes life endurable, I can bear the torture no longer, and shall cast myself from this garret window into the squalid street below. Do not think from my slavery to morphine that I am a weakling or a degenerate. When you have read these hastily scrawled pages, you may guess, though never fully realize, why it is that I must have forgetfulness or death. It was in one of the most open and least frequented parts of the broad Pacific that the packet of which I was supercargo fell a victim to the German sea raider. The Great War was then at its very beginning, and the ocean forces of the Hun had not completely sunk to their later degradation, so that our vessel was made a legitimate prize, whilst we of her crew were treated with all the fairness and consideration due us as naval prisoners. So liberal, indeed, was the discipline of our captors that 5 days after we were taken, I managed to escape alone in a small boat with water and provisions for a good length of time. When I finally found myself adrift and free, I had but little idea of my surroundings. Never a competent navigator, I could only guess vaguely by the sun and stars that I was somewhat south of the equator. Of the longitude I knew nothing, and no island or coastline was in sight. The weather kept fair, and for uncounted days I drifted aimlessly beneath the scorching sun, waiting either for some passing ship or to be cast on the shores of some habitable land. But neither ship nor land appeared, and I began to despair in my solitude upon the heaving vastness of unbroken blue. The change happened whilst I slept. Its details I shall never know, for my slumber, though troubled and dream-infested, was continuous. When at last I awaked, it was to discover myself half-sucked into a slimy expanse of hellish black mire which extended about me in monotonous undulations as far as I could see, and in which my boat lay grounded some distance away. Though one might well imagine that my first sensation would be of wonder at so prodigious and unexpected a transformation.
Can you hear me?
And in the rotting soil, a sinister wallet.
Okay. Let me know if you have any problem with the music. I just turned it on. I haven't checked it. It might break up just a little bit until I kill Carrington here. Which I just did. So yeah, that was cool, man. The mixer commented on my post, man. That was cool as crap. Oh, speaking of, I gotta take some pictures. That's what I've been meaning to do. Hey, man, I know you're a person of faith also. I'll be saying a prayer for my dad. He goes back out tonight. He's in pretty good pain. I'm going to give him to the doctors tomorrow. I kind of wanted to go tonight, but over to the hospital, but he wouldn't go. I gave him some of my pain medicine and muscle relaxer, and he seemed to be doing okay. He finally slept. And I lay down and went to sleep, so. See, I don't have Twitter on here, do I? T-U-R-S-T. No Twitter. So, let me send this to... I'm going to send you a picture. Okay, cool. I'm going to send you a picture. It's the picture of the Legos. If I can figure out how to do that. Yeah. I open Steam on my phone, and it says, never show your password. Never send anyone your password. Oh. I guess I can't. Oh, no, not that. Oh, I guess the Steam chat doesn't support pictures on phone. That kind of sucks. Okay, well, I'll do it in Discord then. Discord. Harrington, General, Picture, Legos. Okay, Dookie, sending that. Yeah, I think I'm going to tool around for about an hour. Oh, what icon's that? Oh, crap. It's telling me my computer needs to reboot for updates. Yeah, it can wait. Discord. And open original. Copy image. And then I can put that over here so you can see it. Oh, it's too large, it says. Can I do it as a link? Copy. Close. Paste. Well, I was hoping it would load it, but it didn't. Anyway, the picture's in Discord. I'm going to post it on. Thank you. Yeah, it came out really nice. Bring my tweet up, and I'm going to add another tweet on top of it. I guess that's what I do. How do I reply? I don't want to add another tweet. I want to reply. Reply. There we go. That's not what I want to do either. I want to copy image. Project. Lego set. 60183. 60183. Heavy. All. Special. Cargo. Okay. All right. Let's see. Time for some trucking. Think I'm going to buy me another truck to start upgrading on. I've got the Volvo maxed out on upgrades. Just don't know which truck yet. What's a good truck to have? Peterbilt or Kenworth? I don't know. Jay Kenworth? Okay. I'll have to go check him out. Alright, we want Trucker MP. Looks like there's an update. Yeah, there's an update. Yeah, that was a small update, so. They don't have a change log in here to say what they changed. There's still a lot of people on, man. 637 players. It was 850 last night. Have you hauled the boat yet in the new, some of the new stuff we've got? We got a boat now. It's in the special transport. And the three trucks. Yeah, this is cool, man. I like the boat was huge. That thing was, man. All right, let's go to radio. Yeah, that thing's huge. I think there's another one also. That's not in the heavy haul. I mean, it might be in heavy haul, but it's not in transport. I got music going. Let's see. I am in. Where am I? I'm in. No. Why am I? That's weird. Where am I? I'm in rail export between Bakersfield and Fresno. So I could go either way, really. I could go to Fresno, Huron, or Bakersfield. Let's see what's out there. Fresno, but Fresno to Eklo. Fresno to Gallup. Gallus. That's a hazmat load. I haven't pulled much hazmat load, so I'm gonna grab that one. It's good. Standard delivery. I don't know, but the Fresno to Elko looks good. It's a heavy haul plus a urgent. And how about you, cargo? I might take it. It's, plus, it's $3,000 more. Be careful, we changed the GPS settings. For some reason, my truck was locked on. Somehow got locked on to the TV. Speed limit. My truck went more than 65 miles an hour. I didn't forever figure out how to get turned off. Something else I thought would be kind of cool to do is if I can figure out how to do it, to pull the trucker MP server and have it tell what time it is in the server, in the game world. So like right now it's Friday at 4 a.m. It'd be kind of cool if I could use a microcontroller I've got, one of those LED displays, and have it update the time. Other one. I wish it was real time, but I could see maybe why they would want it that way. I still don't like it. I'd like to have a steering wheel and shifter. That was all. Doing, but I had stopped it in the middle of a two-lane road, and I was switched over to a message, or what, but I had switched out of the game. I had bought the road for a bunch of people and they were all yelling on the TV. Popular stream, so I'm gonna try to do them at least once every 2 weeks so I can get Mrs. Cheddar talked into it. You know, I don't have to do the big sets like this. Yeah, even though this one was only $3, so that's not bad. But some of the nicer sets, like the one I'm wanting, the one of the full semi, is not right now $99. That's a little over my price point for Legos. Another driver up here in Fresno. Who's this? B.H. Marcos. Not anybody I know. That's you in the horn. I noticed my truck, man. My truck looks like the car that's from Dr. Trailer's not sleeping on the ground. So far, it's not awesome. I wish you were here, man. The heavy haul dozer. Oh, it's sinking into the ground, though. I gotta take a picture of this. Pick this up. be a Chris. There, Chris. Who are you at in the game? Jesus, I am so... Armageddon? Okay, cool. I hope you can hear me okay. I don't have a headset on tonight. Yeah, my net's been acting up. Might be time for a reset on everything. Yeah, I just heard the music break up a little bit. Oh, here's your song, Chris. Oh, no, it ain't. Well, it's Reckless Club, this song. Still a good song, man. That would be really cool. What scene with a big darkness? It'd be really cool. I did hear. Don't buy fuel in California. Good Lord. This last time I got fuel, it was $4.12 a gallon. It cost me over $1,000 to fill my truck up. So before I came out of Nevada, last time I filled up. I think after this float, I'm going to fast travel to Albuquerque and create my shop. I might buy a little truck and hire another job. Yes. quickly. I'm going to ask you a question. How do you see if a player's logged in or not into the multiplayer? I meant to ask you that because I know you said it was some amount of opponents is logging in. I didn't know if there was a command you can type to make it show up. Oh, on Discord. Oh, okay. And then you can go, you press Y and go to the chat menu, type in /players, and it'll tell you how many players are on the server. Actually, I think you type help, which is y'all's commands, /help. 2, I think, comes in play. Trailers floating. Yeah, you know, you seen the trailers floating in the air? Here's one that was sinking. This one was sinking to the ground. That's a pretty bad day. Hey, boss man. Yeah, that's not a good thing. And it happens. It really does happen. Apparently, asphalt is really porous. And, if you drop a loaded trailer on a hot asphalt, it will sink. It'll sink right through it. Company I worked for, they had concrete slabs. I guess my truck's passing me here. They poured concrete strips in their parking lot, and you had to park right where the legs would hit the concrete. Luckily, I never had that happen to me. About turned the trailer over one time, though. That was good. It'd be great to get in there. There's a bunch of trucks passing. I'm not saying a car. Hey, guys. Sorry about that. I thought I got over far enough. Apparently not. Oh, That's all right. That's been all week. Yeah. It looks like I got in the middle of the convoy pictures. I'm just kind of sitting in the road. I thought I could get all the way up the road, but... Sweet, what'd you get this time? You stick with the Volvo or did you get something else? Kenworth, good deal. I'm gonna grab one as soon as I do finish this load, I think. I'll put a driver in the Volvo. W900? That's a long hood, ain't it?